Welcome back to the new updates of COVID-2019. This is the continuation of the updates which was done on 19th of this month. I would like to stress on two topics. One, steroids in COVID, and second, MODs. This time also, I am having some disclaimers. COVID is a new disease and our understanding of the disease is evolving. There is no time for RCT trials as of now. Most of the literatures are expert opinions or limited data with lots of limitation. So basically an anecdotal idea. My opinion about the disease is prone to change once we get more information. In few of the reference, I have taken some preprint articles. It basically means new medical research that has yet to be evaluated, so should not be used to guide clinical practice. First topic is about the theoretical advantages and disadvantages of steroids in COVID-19. This will be followed by the evidence and guidelines of steroid as of now. Next topic of discussion will be about the MODs, that is a multi-organ disorders in COVID-19. Last time we discussed about the lung and ventilatory management followed by a renal and hematological involvement. Today we will be discussing about the cardiac, neurological and GI manifestation of COVID-19. First, we will start with the basic of initial reaction of the virus to the body and the reaction of the body to the virus. Once again, we are in the early phase of our attempts to understand the syndromic complexity of COVID-19. Immunological response of COVID-19 has been found to be very similar with SARS and MERS. So some assumptions are made that both of them are having similar response. These are the main references which I have taken for the discussion. This is the COVID-19 virus. It is having three proteins. The S protein or spike protein, which actually help to attach the cell to the ACE2 receptors. The E or envelope protein, which is having immunological properties, and we are having EM or membrane property, which is also having immunological properties. This is another schematic diagram of the virus, where inside we can see the nucleocapsid protein. The virus gets entry to the body through the upper airway tract and gets attached with the help of the receptors. This stage is known as the asymptomatic phase, or the initial 1 to 2 days of infection. The inhaled SARS-CoV virus 2 binds to the epithelial cells in the nasal cavity and starts replicating. The ACE2 receptors act as a receptor attachment. There is local propagation of the virus but with a limited innate immune response. At this stage, the virus may be detected by nasal swab. From the upper airway, it gains entry to the lung, and once it enters the lung, it is going to get deposited in the distal alveoli. Once it enters the alveoli, it is having an increased affinity towards the type 2 pneumocytes than the type 1 pneumocyte. The type 2 pneumocyte is responsible for surfactant production, which decreases the surface tension in the alveoli and keeps it open. It also acts as an alveolar reserve cell, which can convert into type 1 pneumocyte in case of lung injury. Now we'll go towards the stage 2 after the stage 1. This is the upper airway and conducting airway response in the next few days. At this time, the disease is clinically manifested. The level of CXCL10 and innate response cytokine is increased. About 80% of the infected patient, the disease will be mild and mostly restricted to the upper or conducting airways. Now, how does it get attached to the type 2 pneumocyte? It is mainly through the ACE2 receptors, which is present in the type 2 cell. It is also present in the type 1 cell, but it is more having an affinity more towards the type 2 cell. The virus gets attached with the help of two receptors. One is the ACE2 receptor, as I said, which attaches to the spike protein of the virus. And there is one more receptor, the TMPRSS2 receptors, which actually help in endocytosis of the virus with the receptors. This is a schematic diagram of the flowchart. Here we can see the SARS-CoV-2. having S protein. It gets attached to the ACE2 receptors, and with the help of TMPRSS2 receptors, is getting endocytosized inside the cell. From here, actually, it goes for the uncoating. Once uncoating happens, translation happens, and it goes towards the polypeptide production. Proteolysis happens, and with the help of the RNA dependent RNA polymerase, it leads to RNA synthesis, which will lead to the translation, assembly, and at last the virus gets exocytosis. This is a human electron microscope of type 2 cell with SARS-CoV-1, not COVID-2. Here we can see the viral particle in the double membrane vesicles. This is another one where we can see the virus along the apical microvilli, which is mainly through the exocytosis. Is ACE2 receptors only seen in type 2 pneumocytes? No, it is seen in the type 1. It is seen in the enterocytes of the human intestine. It is seen in the brush border of the proximal convoluted tubule in the kidney. It is seen in the endothelial cells, in the artery, as well as smooth cells in many of the cells. This is an imprint of ACE2 and TMPRSS receptors in the kidney. Here we can see that we are having a higher concentration in the podocyte and proximal convoluted tubule. Among the ACE2 receptors, we can see it is mainly seen in the proximal convoluted tubule, whereas TMPRSS is mainly seen in almost all other areas. This is a postmortem autopsy of a kidney of a patient who suffered from COVID-19. This was done in China, where they were able to show the virus inclusion inside the kidney. From here, it goes to the type 3 stage, stage 3, where we will be having hypoxia, ground glass infiltrates, and progression to ARDS. And the cell that is preferentially infected is going to be the type 2 compared to the type 1. The infected alveolar unit tend to be peripheral and subpleural. And in the CT, we can demonstrate it, showing the ground glass appearance mainly in the peripheral, patchy, and the subpleural area also, which is characteristic of the COVID. And recovery usually will require a vigorous innate and acute immune response. So to summarize, the virus as such is having two issues. One, it can cause local damage and replication. At the same time, it can start an immunological response of the body against the virus. This local damage leads to the death of the type 2 pneumocytes. And there are very few observations stating that lysis process in type 2 is not that predominant. So if things goes fine, like in the stage 1 or 2, the immunological process will be strong enough to contain the virus and the infection, and most of the patients recover. Innate immunity will be followed by the adaptive one. But in a subgroup of patients, the immunological response will be unchecked, and this can lead to MORS. Meanwhile, the cells of the immune system can also be directly infected by the SARS-CoV-2. So once again, we are having two responses: the direct pathological damage to the lung followed by the antivirus immunity. This is a model of COVID pathogenesis. The blue arrow shows the pathway with data available. The gray arrows are the pathway without much data. It's a proposed pathway. And SARS-CoV-2 infects the pneumocytes, and this will recruit the macrophages. The macrophage will produce distinct amount of cytokines like MIG, IP10, MCP, and later leads to recruitment. And this is gone unchecked, this will lead to the cytokine storm. This is a pictorial diagram of the same. So in short, immune responses in mild cases results in viral clearance. This is likely because of the type 1 interferon antiviral response and CD4 Th1 and CD8 TSCL response. In severe cases, there is a delay in the antiviral response, And if when unchecked, this will go for the cytokine storm. This cytokines interlocking 1, 6, 12 and tissue necrosis factor leads to increased permeability and may cause respiratory failure. Another hallmark of severe disease is going to be the lymphopenia. This is a very important diagram which was published in the Journal of Heart and Lung Transplantation recently, where they proposed a clinical targeting staging of COVID-19 response. Most of our treatment nowadays is based on this concept. Here it is divided into stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3. Stage 1 is the viral response phase, where we can see the viral response is very much in this part. And once you go to stage 2, that is the pulmonary response phase, the virus response is coming down, whereas the host inflammatory response phase starts to pick up. And once you reach the stage 3, that is the hyperinflation phase, it is mainly about the host inflammatory response phase. So stage 1 is the early infection. This stage occurs at the time of inoculation and early establishment of the disease. For most of the people, this involves an incubation period with mild symptoms. Diagnosis is based on the PCR and some amount of the CBC will show abnormality. Treatment is mainly symptomatic relief. And if we had an antiviral therapy, specific antiviral therapy would have been beneficial during this stage. From here, we go to the stage 2. It is again divided into stage 2A and 2B based on the hypoxia. If you are having tachypnea, it is stage 2A. And if you are having hypoxia, it goes to stage 2B. Probably here, corticosteroids might be having a role. And from here, we go towards the stage 3, which is a systemic hyperinflation stage, where minority of the COVID-19 patient will be transitioned from stage 2 to stage 3. Here the prognosis is going to be bad. Again, here we can see in the stage 1 we are having mild constitutional symptoms. Stage 2 we are having shortness of breath. If the hypoxia comes under stage 2B, and we are having hyperinflation phase also. And these are the potential therapeutic therapies which can be tried during this time. This is all theoretical data. Probably corticosteroids might be helping the late stage. So what happens if you're giving steroids at the early stage? Administration of steroids during the early infection could increase the viral replication, and perhaps this can delay the development of adaptive immunity. These can be or might be detrimental, which we are not sure. So giving steroids in stage 1 is very difficult to suggest. As I said, in stage 2 in the pulmonary phase, clinically patient will be having sudden deterioration. They will be going for ARDS. The markers of systemic inflammation will be moderately elevated biologically. This is an adaptive immune response with increased level of inflammation. Some immunosuppression may be beneficial. So this is stage 2, as I said. And if you are going to stage 3, what happens is that there will be more damage in the alveoli. Here we can see the normal alveoli at the early stage. In severe stage, you are having a lot of inflammatory mediators. So in stage 3, we are having the cytokine storm. Clinically, we can diagnose this patient based on the DIC modes. There will be very much a high elevation of D-dimer, CRP and ferritin. Clinical deterioration may be after an initial improvement. Biologically, this is an adaptive immune response which leads to dysregulated cytokine storm, and it is likely it represents the virus induced HLH phase. This is the stage 3 where the prognosis is going to be bad, and treatment from stage 2 will be continued here, and probably a more aggressive immunomodulatory therapy is likely required. This is a very good flow chart where they try to find patients with COVID based on the bilateral infiltrates and PCR. And if the patient had a severe respiratory failure, they will check for lab evidence of inflammation like ferritin and CRP if they are high. We check evidence for the cytokine storm if they are having high D-dimer and high LDH. And if the patient is not having any immunosuppression, they will be considered as a case for immunomodulatory therapy, including steroid. And which steroid is better? As we know, the glucocorticoid receptors is having the anti-inflammatory effect, and mineralocorticoid effect might be having some detrimental effect. So it is possible that Dexona or dexamethasone, a pure glucocorticoid agonist, could be a cleaner steroid than the most. So it's about the right drug at the right dose when it is needed. Now we'll check about the guidelines, what the guidelines is. For guidelines, we require evidence. So unless otherwise we are having a strong evidence, it is very difficult to give in the guidelines. An absence of evidence doesn't mean that evidence of absence. So this is a CDC guideline 2000 about the COVID virus 2019, where they said, therefore, corticosteroids should be avoided unless indicated for other reason, such as COPD or septic shock. This is about the severe COPD cases. And here is the assessment of evidence of 2019 COVID. This was updated on 24th 4th, that's the this month, and they found here in general recommendation WHO, CDC and NIH generally recommends against the routine use of corticosteroids unless we are having other indication. In non-critical patient, steroids should not be used because it can inhibit the immune response. In critically ill patient, in survey sepsis guidelines, for patient without ARDS, no use of corticosteroids. If the patient is having ARDS, it is going to be a weak recommendation. NIH also recommend the same thing. Without ARDS, no steroids. The patient is having ARDS, they are having insufficient data. What about cytokine storm? This is some area which everyone is interested. There is no well-established or evidence-based treatment for cytokine storm. Some experts, this is expert opinion, suggest more potent immunosuppressions with corticosteroids might be a higher dose of corticosteroids. So to summarize this part, immunomodulatory drugs may have a role in cytokine storm-like syndrome. It is very difficult to find whether the patient is on cytokine storm or progression of the viral disease. Inflammatory markers like IL-6 may help, but not always available bedside. And also, the patient population may have a role in cytokine-driven ARDS, like immunocompromised versus immunocompetent patient. Steroids may have a role in ARDS if it is beyond the viral replication. And it's basically the exceptional ICU supportive and management which needs for a better outcome. So coming to the other organ involvement, now we'll discuss about the organ involvement in the heart. And we will try to understand the cardiac manifestation of COVID-19. This was the news which got published yesterday. This was about the autopsy done on the first recorded COVID case in US, saying that the patient died because of the massive heart attack. And this is the autopsy report of the patient, which was given in the link. It was done on February 7, 2020. In the respiratory system, the lung parenchyma is mildly congested and shows no significant edema. And they were able to find molecular evidence of SARS-CoV-2 in the heart, trachea, lung, intestine. And other thing is that they found the patient had a transmural myocardial infarction with minor components of myocarditis. There was rupture of left ventricle, in which this led to cardiac tamponade. Interestingly, no coronary atherosclerosis or thrombosis was found in this patient. So the cause of death of the first case in US was acute hemopericardium due to rupture of left ventricle due to transmural myocardial infarction with minor component of myocarditis due to COVID-19. What about the ECS guidance about COVID-19 in the pandemic? The main cardiovascular complication was arrhythmia, myocarditis, ACS, venous thromboembolism, cardiogenic shock and heart failure. And this is the proposed mechanism where they shown the COVID virus can directly affect the endothelial cell. As a part of the inflammation, you will be having the cytokine storm. And this can lead to fulminant myocarditis and myocardial damage, which can be the reason of the arrhythmia, heart failure and ACS. And they have mentioned that severe COVID-19 infection associated with myocardial damage and cardiac arrhythmias. And monitoring of the cardiac toxicity of antiviral drugs is recommended. This is another article saying about the cardiac arrhythmia complication in patients with COVID-19. Here they went through the literature and they found that arrhythmia was around 16.7% in Wang et al. Study, and
They also found that acute cardiac injury was 7.2%. Interestingly, in another study of 191 patients, 23% of the patients had heart failure. And the autopsy done was mainly about the right ventricle. And they also mentioned a proposed mechanism for this COVID-19, where we are having, in addition to the cardiopulmonary deconditioning and peripheral deconditioning. And this is a case report that came on the JAMA about cardiac involvement in the patient with COVID-19. It's in March 27. They said that acute myopericarditis with systolic dysfunction confirmed on cardiac MRI a week after the onset of fever and dry cough. So they concluded saying that this case highlights cardiac involvement as a complication associated with cardiac COVID-19 even without symptoms and signs of interstitial pneumonia. So it can be a first line of presentation. An autopsy study showed right ventricular dilatation in most of the patient with scattered or very minimal myocyte necrosis with a patent coronaries, and cardiomegaly was very minimal. What about the GA manifestation in COVID-19? This is a preprint article which came on Annals of Surgery few days back. It's about the GA complication in critically ill patient with COVID-19. This was the data collected between March 13th and April 12th. Total 141 patients was admitted, and here we can see that most of the patient, around 90.8% patient, required mechanical ventilation. So this is a very sick group, and GA complication was found in around 74%. That is, more than 100 patients had GA complication. The GA manifestation during admission was mainly about abdominal distension, vomiting and diarrhea. Most of them had an NG tube, as we expected. And hepatobiliary complication was seen in around 68% of the patient, like transaminitis. Only one patient had acute pancreatitis. One patient had hepatic ischemia necrosis. And hypermotility complication was common. Around 55% to 60% had hypermotility. Ogliu-like syndrome was seen in 2%. Bowel ischemia, interestingly, was seen in around 4% of the patient. Here we can see the X-ray showing Ogliu-like syndrome. And this is the open laparotomy done in a patient, which shows diffuse patchy necrosis of the entire small bowel, right colon, involving large and short stretches of wall. And there's a clear demarcation, the round shape and the antimesenteric location. What about the neurological manifestations seen in COVID-19? The proposed theory is that there is mainly three pathways. One is through the cribriform plate, which can affect the smell and other system. Second is the spread through the systemic circulation, or can be a part of the immunological response. This is an article which came from Italy in NAGM. It's mainly a correspondence saying that they found around 5 patients who developed GBS after the onset of COVID-19 after 7 to 10 days. This JAMA article came from Wuhan, China, looking to the neurological manifestation hospitalized patient, and they found that the data was collected between January 16th and February 19th. 78 patients, that is around 40% of the patient, had neurological manifestation. 6% had CVA and 15% had altered sensorium. And this is a CT showing the ischemic path, as well as the X-ray, the CT of the chest showing the bilaterally ground glass opacity patch.